strategy, I always go live on Facebook. And so this is new for me. So I thought I would try this out and see how this goes. Thank you. I appreciate you, love. I really do. Hey, Trey, how are you, love? I appreciate you. I don't know. I've never gone live on IG before, but I said, let me try and see what this is about. And I thought I would at least come on and say thank you to all the prayers and all the DMs and the text messages, even before I heard the news, because I was running around and doing things today. But today was, I don't know, I guess for me, the end of an era. I started out my career. Paul Mooney was one of the first people that I met and who took an interest in my career, in me, not my career. I didn't have a career yet. But he took an interest in me. And so any of you who got in the book, I talk about the relationship, the friendship that ensued over 25 years ago with Mooney. And I haven't processed how I feel yet today, because I've had back-to-back interviews that were pre-scheduled today, so I haven't really had a chance to process it all. But I know what he meant to me, and I felt like I needed to say something, even though I haven't fully processed my emotions and all of that, or what I'm feeling or what I'm thinking. I guess I could share a little bit about how I met Paul Mooney. I remember the first time I saw him, and I talk about this in the book. I was in Los Angeles, and there was this place called George's back in the day, and I believe Norm Nixon, I think Debbie Allen, you know, because they were married, partnership, I think Denzel Washington. But anyway, it was the hot spot in Hollywood, and anybody who was anybody could be seen there. This was like the mid-90s, and I believe it was on Melrose, called Georgia. And so I remember going there when I would frequent LA, as I do before COVID. For the last 15, 20 years, I've been going back and forth between DC and LA. But anybody who was anybody would be at this place called Georgia. And I remember one day Will Smith and Johnny Cochran and all these people walked in. And then I remember one night I was there and Paul Mooney walked in. And he just looked mean to me. He looked mean to me. I couldn't say hello. I wanted to say hello, but I didn't know what was going to happen if I said hello. So I just stood there and stared, you know. And he didn't like approachable, so I didn't. So a couple years later, when I started working for the Comedy Connection over operations, I knew Mooney was on slate to perform that weekend. And I remember praying and like, God, I'm such an introvert. I said, please let him speak to me first. And I see you, Ashera. And so I said, God, please let him speak to me first. So when he came in to the club, he stopped. I was near the front. He stopped and he said, I said, hi, how are you, Mr. Mooney? I tried to greet him with a smile and my energy. And he just looked at me deadpanned, no smile, and said, what do you do? And so I said, well, I help the headliners when they come in, and I see if there's anything they need. And I said, I help with the marketing and the promotions, and that's kind of what I do. And so he said, no, I meant, what do you really do? And he's still staring at me deadpan, no smile. And I said, well, right now I'm a senior engineer. And I said, I just completed my dual master's in engineering and management, concentration in contract law, but I think God is moving me to work in the entertainment industry. And so he said, I knew you were the goddamn truth. And that was how I met Paul Mooney. And so then I watched him go on stage and perform 3.5 hours to a sold out standing room only crowd. And when he came off stage, he came back over to me. He said, walk with me, come talk to me. And so we went into the corner of that comedy club and we talked for almost 3 hours. That was how I met Paul Mooney. And at the end of that conversation, he said, I know that you're going to kill this industry. People are going to like you. And he said, because you're not full of the bullshit of this industry. And that was 26 years ago in 1995 when we first met. And we continued to cross paths. Every time we crossed paths, he made time to talk to me. He made time to sit and, share stories. And so at the end of that first conversation, he said, I would work for you for free. And he said, if you ever need me, call me. And this was Paul Mooney back in the day. This was not Paul Mooney now. This is 26 years ago when he said, I will work for you for free. This was Paul Mooney writing for Richard Pryor. This is Paul Mooney writing for Red Fox, Paul Mooney. And he said, I will work for you for free. He said, you're going to turn this industry on its head. I didn't even know what God had for me in this industry, but evidently he saw something in me I couldn't see in myself yet. And so between him, and I talk about it in my book, D.L. Hughley, General Colin Powell and Robert L. Johnson, those four men shaped my career. And that's why I've had a 26 years in the entertainment industry. And so I don't know how I feel right now. I haven't processed it all. Like I said, I just finished doing two interviews that were previously scheduled and had nothing to do with today. But I thank you all for the outpouring of love and support. Mooney has been an integral part of my life. We had a bond that I couldn't be explained. He would laugh and was almost giddy around me when a lot of times he could throw some attitude at other people, but we always laughed and talked for hours every time we saw each other. And so, as I talk about in the book, I was blessed to be with him and Dick Gregory the last time they performed together. And that was beyond memorable. I was blessed to be with Dick Gregory one of the last times he performed, not with Mooney, but the time where they performed together for the last time I was there. And then I was with Dick Gregory, I think maybe 2 months before he passed away, one of his last performances. It might have been his last performance. I was with him as well. And I started not to stay, because there were so many people who wanted to talk to him after his show. And something said, sit down and wait. And so we had a chance to sit down and talk when he finished, signing autographs and all of that stuff. And we sat down for about an hour and talked. And so I was blessed to spend time with Dick Gregory 2 months before he died. We sat and talked for about an hour. And I was with Mooney. I believe it may have been the last time he performed a couple of years ago. And we were backstage. His memory had started to fail and having health issues and stuff. So I wasn't sure he would remember me because in recent times, it seemed like a struggle for him to remember, even connect with anything, but it was heartbreaking. I think the first time I saw him and he was sick was 2016. And when I first walked backstage, before the show, I said, hey, Mooney. Like I had for 20 years previously. And he would always say, hey, sweetie. And so he didn't say anything. He just stared at me. And I was like, that's when I knew something was wrong. This was 2016. And so I sat down beside him and we kept talking. And at some point, he remembered who I was. He started making the connection. And we sat there until it was time for him to go on stage. And then the next night, this is Philly 2016, we had a candid conversation. And then Dick Gregory came over because they were performing in Philly that weekend too. This is 2016. Dick Gregory came over and sat down because, Mooney was out of it. And it was the two best friends of over 4 decades having a candid conversation and just the three of us sitting there. And I remember just recording that moment. Literally, it's never been seen before. I've just kept it in my personal archives of the two best friends and Dick Gregory encouraging Paul Mooney and saying, you got to focus. He couldn't figure out exactly what was going on, because he was getting up in age too, but he knew something was wrong with his best friend. And he said, you got to focus. He said, these people came to see you. And he said, people have been standing around buildings for 30, 40 years just to see Paul Mooney. He said, they don't come to see me. They come to see you. And so I have that footage of them. And I thought about that today. And then the last time we were together, I didn't want to go backstage. And Christian Gregory was there. He'd been my friend since college. And it was Paul Mooney and Dick Gregory performing. And this was next to the last time I think he performed. But Christian said, have you been backstage yet? I said, no. I said, I don't want to go because it almost broke my heart the two times before where it was hard for him to remember me. And so he said, no, he's better tonight. And so I went backstage and we were sitting in the green room and I didn't speak to Mooney when I walked in the green room like I normally do. I just started speaking to his family who was there. It was his cousin, Carol, and there was another gentleman. I can't think of his name right now, but he was always with Mooney. And I spoke to them first, you know, and I sat down. And when I sat down, Mooney said, hey, sweetie. And I knew he was present. And we sat there talking about, they asked me what I was working on. I said, I have a 501c3 now. And I started telling about the programs with the kids and stuff like that that we're doing. And Mooney got into the conversation. And I felt like God allowed me to have one more moment with him. And he said, I'm so proud of you. And he said, you ought to do some stuff in the Bay Area. And he started really, he was really in the conversation, which hadn't happened in years. And I felt like that was all God, you know, and giving me my moment, you know, to say goodbye. And he said, and then he reached over and touched my hand. And he said, I know. He said, I'm still here. Anytime you need me, I'm here. And that was my last moment with Mooney a couple of years ago. I think it was probably his last performance. And I remember I talk about it in the book because he was a different Mooney that night. Well, not different to me, but different than I think the public had seen him. Because when he was on stage, he had a moment where he thanked them for loving him for almost four decades. And he thanked them for being there for him. And he told the audience, I love you. And so I chronicle that in my book because in my heart, I knew it was his way of saying thank you and resting the mic. And so I just wanted to take a moment and at least acknowledge my friend, my mentor. He started off being there for me. And then over the years, I was blessed to be there for him. And so I'm just thankful. I'm honored, you know, that God allowed it to be. And like I said, this is my first time ever going live on IG, but I just felt like I wanted to say something in honor of him and to commemorate his life and at least give my standpoint on who Mooney was. I was the first person to put him on nationwide radio, too. I talked about that on Clubhouse today when they asked me to make some remarks. That was one of my favorite moments with Paul. This was, I guess, early 2000s, and he wasn't really on radio like that. He wasn't on there at all. I don't know if it was because they were afraid of him because he didn't want to do it, but I know I was at Radio 1 headquarters, and I told them I was going to see Mooney and they were like, are you friends? I was like, yeah, we're beyond friends. That's my mentor. And like, can you get him on the Rush Hour morning show in the morning? And so I said, like, I don't know, I can call. And so I called and I talked him into doing the Rush Hour morning show. And so then the next morning, 6 a.m., we're walking into Radio 1 headquarters and I realized what I've done. And I'm like, he's getting ready to be live. It's no telling what Mooney's going to say. And so I said, hey, Mooney, this is going to be live radio. You think you cannot curse? And he was like, they better keep their finger on that goddamn mute button. And so that was typical Mooney. But he went through that interview and only dropped one F-bomb. And then he looked at me and winked because I knew he did on purpose. But that was Mooney. And that's one of my favorite moments with him. But there have been many over the over the 20 something years, you know, before illness kind of set in, even after illness set in. I talk about that in my book, some of the moments in the last 5 years that God allowed me to experience with my friend and mentor and conversations we had. And so I'm so glad I chronicled it and made it a keepsake, you know, as well as, you know, for the public to know who he was to me. And so that's all. That's what I wanted to share. And I think I needed to say it out loud. I think I needed to get it off my chest, you know, but I feel blessed. I feel blessed that he, I'm sure, is in a better place and that his spirit will always be with us. I know it'll be with me. His words of wisdom, everything he ever told me, everything he ever taught me, every conversation will always be with me. So I'm honored that God allowed us to have a friendship that lasted over 20 something years, and that he saw something in me I didn't see in myself. And so, as I celebrate 26 years in the entertainment industry, I've got to pay homage to the godfather of comedy, who was one of the first to sit down and talk with me and encourage me to have my own business and continue to encourage me over the years and check in with me. There was never a time I called his cell phone he didn't pick up on the second ring in 20 something years. And so I'm just so thankful and so grateful for the relationship we had. I'm thankful for the time we got to spend, you know, over the last few years. So that's kind of my Paul Mooney story. So I just want to thank you guys for tuning in. And, you know, that's kind of it. So thank you all.